Hi, friends. Welcome to Weekend Extra at Grace Church. We're so glad you're joining us. I'm Hannah Nitz with my good friend here, the Bogue Man, Jeff Bogue. And we are super excited to dive into our conversation from this weekend's sermon talking about right now. Right now.
Right now.
And right now, we are going to talk about you talking about right now.
I like it.
So, Jeff, one of the things that I love, so you taught today through this conversation about David and Solomon.
Yep.
And about David choosing to invest in and pour into intentionally into Solomon. Our question to start out with is, how do we find a Solomon? You gave a great story, a very practical example of Knut Larson doing that for you. And I'm sure there are a lot of people who wanted that from Knut Larson. Any wisdom on how to discern who we choose that to be our Solomon?
So in a lot of ways, I would probably flip that and say a Solomon needs to find a David. And so
I wasn't expecting that.
I know, threw you a curveball there, right? So I when I think about it, like the mentors I've had in my life, I sought out. So rarely if I had somebody look at me and say, hey, you got a lot of potential, you know, I want to invest in you, that would all probably feel weird generally to me. But like a Knut Larson, for instance, I sought him out. He had retired and was doing some consulting and stuff like that, and I knew about that. And so I really wanted to know his wisdom. And so I sought him out, made the appointment, and then Knut is wonderful and invested in me from there. And same thing with Bob Combs. I was given an opportunity to come onto the staff of Grace Church, and so that's how I did that. I took that opportunity. I wanted to make my first ministry at a healthy church with a pastor that I respected, and so I kind of filtered that a little bit and sought Bob out. So I would tend to flip it that way and say, if you are the Solomon, if you're the one who's looking for the mentor, looking for the leader, you should pursue that. And you can, whether it's professionally or relationally, those kind of things. If you're a young married couple and you see a couple that has a healthy marriage, or maybe they've been married 25 years, go to them and say, would you invest in me? And I think you'd be surprised how many people will say yes in some way. Some people will say, I can't right now. And so you just keep looking. But I think that's like step one. If it's the other way around, where it's the David and the Solomon, then what I look for in a guy that I'm investing in is I want them to be teachable. It's number one. So I'm not looking to argue theology. I'm not looking to argue philosophy. I have settled those things in my mind, and you're going to probably annoy me if that's what you want to do, just to be
real
honest
talk.
With you. Yeah, I'm just being real. But if you look and say, you know, would you teach me? Would you help me? Would you show me? I will generally, if I can, kind of take that first appointment. If you follow up on the things I'm talking to you about, I'll take the second one, you know? And so I look for guys that are teachable and guys that I feel like can really allow me to help shape them. Now, here's the second part of it. I'm also looking for guys that will teach me something. And so I think that's the gold of mentorship, is I'm getting something out of it too. Mm-hmm. And I'm not as young as I used to be. And you know, here at Grace, we really look at the 24-year-old unchurched person is who we want to communicate with. Well, I have to learn that now. It used to come natural to me. It doesn't anymore. And so I like that. I like it when people feed back and they give me ideas. And so when you look for a guy like that, where there's that relationship, they kind of can go somewhere because you're in their life, they're taking you somewhere too. So if I'm looking for a Solomon, that's what I'm looking for. My experience has been, I don't look for many. I find they look for me now. Mm. And that's what I would encourage you. If you are on the climb and you're the younger person, find those people in your life and ask them, will you spend a little bit of time with me? Don't drive them nuts, by the way, you know, but
it annoys Jeff. Don't do that.
Well, because they're busy and they're demanded upon. And like you said, everybody wants to be with Knut Larson. I hung out with Knut after he retired. And he's a friend of mine now, but he had the time. When he was in the thick of it, he didn't have the time to meet with me all the time. He would always take my phone call, which I always really respected and have made a practice of mine also. But when he was available, I signed up.
You hopped on.
Yeah,
absolutely. You found you a David.
I did.
That's what we want.
I did. Yep. It's awesome.
So Jeff, one of the other things you talked about is once, you know, you have that relationship, how intentional David was with passing on his God-given vision to Solomon.
Yeah.
When you said that, it struck me that David had the wisdom to know what his God-given vision was.
Yeah.
How do we know that? How do we know that a vision is God-given and that it's one that we should be leaning into and passing on?
It's a great question, and I don't know if I have a super clean answer for it, but I would say it's in the ballpark of a vision that, of course, is in line with Scripture. You know, so it's a vision that prioritizes the things that God would prioritize. And then I think it's a vision that's eternal. So for me, I really want to give my life to something that's going to go past my life. Hmm. And Jeff Bogue being a superstar dies with me, if it ever even happens. It's kind of,
if it catches on, it's hard to say.
It is, but it's kind of dumb. It's kind of dumb if you think about it.
It ends.
But Jesus Christ being a superstar and I get to be a part of proclaiming his fame is a blast. And so when God gives you a vision like that, so as an example, this isn't the only one, but as an example, our vision here at Grace is 30 churches in 30 years. Well, the church is God's plan, right? That's straight out of Scripture. We would look and say, even the time frame is the book of Acts, so we're drawing all that from Scripture. And then Jesus is famous at the end of the day with it, not the pastor of the church. Mm-hmm. And so we would look and say, and then, by the way, I have a, like the elders of our church would like kind of agree with that. And so we'd say, that's what we want to invest ourselves in. God, in a weird and unique way, like put that in us. That's what we want to do. That's not the only God-given vision. It's just kind of ours, mm-hmm. right? Well, then what happens is you become obsessed with God's plan being played out instead of your plan being played out, you know? And so the role you play in that is almost insignificant. You don't really care where you're at on the depth chart. You care that God is doing what he set out to do. So it's something like that. It's always, everything's in line with Scripture always, right? First, foremost. But then it's kind of in you. It's eternal. It's that kind of a thing.
I love it. Cool. Yeah, I'm thankful that you model that for us here at Grace, just with that vision and our prayers that, you know, those joining our service even this weekend can know and walk out what that looks like for them. That's that awesome. God-given vision. So, Jeff, one last question. I'm just thinking of our sweet friends who were here this weekend and are thinking, that was a great sermon, but I'm not a David. I'm not a boss at work. I'm not a captain somewhere. Yeah. Like, this conversation was great, but I don't think I'm really in a place of influence or any kind of peak. How would you help someone figure out what that looks like in their life? What wisdom would you give them or encouragement to apply this for their situation?
So this is what I would say. I would say if you think that, you're wrong.
Boom.
Boom.
You're wrong.
Mic drop. Right? So I would say you're wrong. That everyone is someone's hero. Hmm. And everyone has an influence on someone. Now, you might look and say, I want to amplify my influence or increase my influence. So maybe you're not the executive at work. Maybe you're the big brother at home. Maybe you're somebody's uncle or somebody's aunt. Maybe this kid down in the inner city who's looking for a dad, you can be that big brother to that person. You are someone's hero, and if you're not, you can be very easily. Hmm. It's a matter of how you position your life. So I never agree when someone says, I'm just me. What do I have to offer anybody? I'm like, wrong. You wouldn't be on the planet if that was the case. Like, God created you with a purpose. He created you and planned in advance good works for you to fulfill, right? And there's a reason God put you on the dirt in this time and in this space, and it's to work through you. So you're right now, that's a catchy way of saying a very deep spiritual truth that God preordained for you right now to be doing what you're doing. You may need to see it differently than you're seeing it right now, but the idea that it doesn't apply to you is just wrong.
Isn't that exciting?
I love it.
It makes me kind of excited, like a little excited dance, because I think so many people go through and just feel like, that's not necessarily me. I'm not that person of influence. And your heart for that, Jeff, of saying like right now, like you are here right now.
Absolutely.
I love it.
If you don't have people that you're influencing right now, somebody somewhere is desperate for you to do that. Hmm. and you seeing it, investing in it. And if you don't have that relationship, you know, call into the church office and we'll connect you with one.
We'll put you to work.
there's literally like millions of people desperate. They're alone. They're hurting. They're abandoned. And a person of God that would give their life to them, it makes me want to cry. Like it's just what God created us for. So that's a false view of ourself. If you're a Christ follower especially, it's just a false view of yourself. I get where it comes from. I want to be sympathetic to that. But it's really not who you are, and certainly not who God created you to be.
Well, Jeff, thanks for that excitement and just that wisdom as a follow-up to some of this. And we still have more Right Now sermons coming up.
Yep.
True?
Bunch of them.
So, friends, stick around. We're so excited to continue this conversation, and we'll see you back here next week on Weekend Extra.